저는 영어로 발표하겠습니다.
Good morning, everyone. I will give you a presentation in Korean.
I am an aircraft conceptual design engineer by training. Now, I am doing a research on UAS and UAM certification at UAM Technical Center of Kiosk. Today, I'd like to talk about UAM demonstration project that I have been involved in since the beginning of last year. Also, I will speak about what we are going to do this year in the later part of my presentation. This talk is nothing about technology or engineering, but will cover a bit of regulatory framework, so please relax and enjoy. I will begin my talk with the project timeline, then we will speak about our efforts we have made to carry out the demonstration project. Then I will show you something about regulatory difference and the requirements we have experienced in the process of getting flight permission. Also, I will comment on the UTM system that we have tested. Also, I will finish my presentation with some of the key lessons learned together with a future plan. Let's have a look at the short video clip first. Video 좀 틀어주겠습니까? Could you please play the video now? I think Mr. Park from Mollet has already showed a very nicely edited video of the whole story in the morning session, so this might look a bit boring. But I think this flight was the one performed at the public park near the Incheon Airport. And now this radar screen shows a flight path of the aircraft. This really short flight has covered some 3 kilometers distance at a speed of maximum 25 knots and has reached some 50 meters height. Okay. Now I will briefly introduce the timeline for the flight demonstration project. This project was initiated in early January last year, led by the Mollet, in order to promote the introduction of the UAM service and to improve social acceptability. In February, a request for information was sent out to some 20 domestic and overseas eVTOL companies in order to secure the UAM aircraft that is needed for the program. Only a few companies showed a positive response, and an NDA was signed with a German eVTOL manufacturer for further communication in March. Next month, two different flight scenarios was proposed by the major airport corporations. Also, German eVTOL startup for air vehicle and the agency for the management of the event were finalized through the technical committees. Then we had a very busy summer last year as we signed an MOU for comprehensive cooperation between Kiosk and the eVTOL company. Also, we had a site survey to fix the corners, and Kiosk visited Germany to double-check the readiness of the aircraft before applying for permission in Korea. After a long period of preparation, the formal application was lodged with the Regional Aviation Office in Seoul, and all the permission issues were cleared. This was the single most difficult part during the whole process of the project. This next slide shows the effort we have made since the beginning of the project early last year. I have to say that It was a real challenge to arrange a flight with a piloted eVTOL aircraft. Many eVTOL companies are claiming that the development are progressing on schedule toward commercialization. However, most were reluctant to join the program with the excuse of focusing on certification. My personal understanding is that flight-ready air vehicles are not readily available yet. Only one German company showed their strong interest with their test aircraft, so we began to communicate in a deeper level, and they finally joined the project. During this long process, we exchanged well over 500 emails, mainly with the overseas eVTOL companies. This is not the end of our efforts. We had to have more than 100 online and offline meetings. The time difference between Korea and the European country means that we had to join the meeting anytime, day and night, if necessary. In addition, in order to respond to the inquiries from the authorities in relation to the permission, as well as to prepare meeting minute and the official documents, numerous technical data provided by the eVTOL company had to be thoroughly reviewed. Moreover, despite the difficult COVID situation, we decided to visit the eVTOL company in Germany in order to avoid any uncertainties in relation to the aircraft and flight permission. This visit was quite successful because we could have witnessed the actual flight on their test site, which showed satisfactory performance in terms of distance and duration required for the demonstration. As all of you may be well aware, there are many uncertainties in relation to the eVTOL aircraft, which is a vital element of the UAM service. We have no regulatory framework for eVTOL or something similar to this type of aircraft. Of course, there exist pathways that you can apply for a type certificate of a new type of aircraft, and this certainly includes eVTOL aircraft. However, not all authorities are ready to accept such new aircraft for certification, to be honest. I cannot explain every single details about the certification process under the Korean Aviation Safety Act. Instead, in short, if you have an aircraft that is registered in Korea, you can apply for airworthiness certificate, including special airworthiness certificate. As you can see from the photo in the middle, EHang has got an HL number on its body, which means this aircraft is registered in Korea. Therefore, this one is eligible for an airworthiness certificate. Volocopter on the right hand, however, is registered in Germany. The registration number DMEVC is definitely from the German authorities. This means that this aircraft is not subject to airworthiness certification in Korea. As per the ICAO rule, only the state of registry may only issue a certificate of airworthiness for registered aircraft. Now, I would like to get into a bit more details about what sort of permissions we needed to carry out the flight demonstration last year at two airports. First, as already commented, domestic use of foreign registered aircraft was the definitely one we had to sort out. This permission is normally issued based on a certificate of airworthiness of an aircraft. However, in the case of Volocopter, this was not available, as Volocopter 2X is classified as an ultralight under the German regulation. So we instead tried to prove its airworthiness via alternative evidence provided by the manufacturer. Sorry to say, but I cannot say more about this due to the confidential information involved. Other than the permission for the aircraft itself, permission for operation below minimum flight altitude was needed to fly below the minimum flight altitude prescribed in the Aviation Safety Act. Also, in the case of the Incheon demonstration, which was performed in the public park near the airport, permission for takeoff and landing other than takeoff and landing site was needed. Then, in order to provide a means to communicate between the aircraft and the ground control under the airport environment, we also needed a radio license for the VHF equipment. Also, the frequency had to be allocated to avoid any conflict with other airliners operating within the same ATC area. Finally, NOTAM has been issued to prohibit the access of other aircraft to the airspace where the demonstration took place. Another important item that had to be considered here was that the Incheon Airport is one of the busiest airports in the world, so we had to try to minimize the duration of the NOTAM. Well, this demonstration included not only simple flight, but also verification of UTM technology to confirm that the UAM aircraft can safely fly within controlled airspace. Toward this end, we tested the system's ability to display both manned aircraft and drones in one radar system using the air traffic monitoring system called ARTS, which means Automated Radar Terminal System, developed in-house by a telecommunication company. A green mark on the screen shows the path of the drone, which we assumed here was delivering a passport to the UAM passenger. A small transponder has been developed and attached to the delivery drone so that we can confirm the ability of the system. This can do the similar role to the ADS-B, which is currently widely used on manned aircraft, providing flight information to the other aircraft. In addition to this, the function of the SWIM system has also been tested during the short flight over the controlled airspace on the airport environment. SWIM means here system-wide information management. This SIM system can display aircraft and flight information, including identification, speed, altitude, so that the control tower can maintain its authority to cope with any emergency situation. There is no doubt that such UTM technologies as SWIM and ARTS are essential for the safe operation of UAM service. Therefore, I am confident to say that the successful validation of UTM system through the airport demonstration program means that we are now ready to introduce the UAM service from the operational perspectives, at least. Okay, finally, I'd like to share some of the key lessons we have learned from the flight demonstration project. First, participating stakeholders may have different areas of interest they wish to get from the demonstration, and this sometimes may lead to conflict of opinions. But we were able to resolve the difference of interest through consensus building that the safe flight is the top priority. The second is the importance of the contingency plan. Given the nature of UAM flight, which has not yet been technically matured and which has no regulatory framework, there exist many uncertainties. With this in mind, from the early stage of the project, we always asked ourselves what if situations and prepared for contingency plans. Next, we came to understand once again that it is necessary to coordinate well in advance with not only the vehicle manufacturer but also authorities regarding permissions. Lastly, and most importantly, without strong commitment from all the stakeholders, including government agencies, eVTOL manufacturer, and the general public, toward the introduction of UAM service in Korea, this project could not have been successful, I can say. This final slide shows a short story of the flight demonstration we have done so far. In 2020, the first eVTOL aircraft from Chinese manufacturer flew in Korean airspace over the Han River with no pilot on board. This marked the first eVTOL flight of its kind in Korea and attracted many spectators. I would say that this event was very successful in that general public could have an opportunity to witness the actual flight of an eVTOL aircraft. Last year, in 2021, we aimed to fly an eVTOL in a piloted mode within airport environment, which was more successful than expected. Now, in 2022, we just began to talk about demonstration project this year. Many are still claiming that they are targeting commercial service in 2024 or 2025 or so. On the other hand, many are forecasting that some or long delays are inevitable. No one knows the definite answer. Nevertheless, we are here today because all of us are looking forward to UAM service for good reasons. One of them I can tell you is that this is essential from the public interest point of view. So I'm confident that flight demonstration project we have done and we are going to do will play a key role by promoting social acceptance as well as by validating technological advancement. Also, such program will be an opportunity to prove government's long-term plan is advancing under control. This time, we may well try autonomous flight or try to carry passengers flying over populated area with a hopefully domestic eVTOL aircraft. It is too early to say something more than this. However, please expect something different from the previous one. We will make progress. Before closing my speech today, I'd like to say that my special thanks goes to those who have been and are involved in the demonstration project. Thank you.